Hello and welcome to Dan Stand. Today I have part two of the interview with former racing driver Jody Firth. In this part, Jody tells us about how he ended up spending some time in prison post-racing and all about how that has affected his life and his family's. And I thank him again for a very open and honest account. I'm sure you'll find this just as fascinating as I did. Were you racing after that until you stopped?
I did another 2 years after that one. But not in that class. I actually returned to GT3 racing in British GT and didn't have particularly good years there. Some years in advance of that, they brought in a system called the balance of performance. So it really doesn't matter nowadays what car you, for GT3 this is, doesn't really matter what car you go and buy anymore. You can buy the latest Ferrari 296, a McLaren 720, a BMW M4. Anybody that manufactures a GT3 car, you know, they all cost different amounts of money. They all have different levels of reliability. They obviously all look different. They all have a bit of nostalgia, sexiness to them. It just comes down to now private, personal preference as to which car you buy. And how much money you've got, because, you know, a Ferrari costs £750,000 now, and a Mercedes is £350,000, £380,000, you know, so there's a massive difference between them. But what happens is, at the beginning of every single year, every manufacturer is invited to the Paul Ricard circuit, and the governing body that dictates GT3 has one driver that they employ, and that driver will drive all of those cars. They'll achieve a lap time in all of them. And then what they then do is they readjust each car to basically try and achieve exactly the same lap time. So they'll do that via, you know, ballast weight, a difference in ride height, or a difference in power. And those are the three things that they can alter in order to achieve that lap time. So, yeah, so when I returned back to GT3, obviously this balance of performance scenario was in, and I actually drove a Porsche that year, which had been super successful in the couple of previous years, but new cars came to the grid that following year that were just a bit of a step above, and the Porsche couldn't quite keep up. So, you know,
did you have kids by this point?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, so we're talking 2013, 14, I think now. So Imogen was born in 2011, and Madison was born in 2012.
Okay.
So yeah, changed my mentality a little bit about, you know, going motor racing. The Imogen was actually present at the Le Mans that I've just described. Madison came the year after, but obviously was there as a baby. But actually, when Imogen was born, I was doing a sports car race at Donington. Something that somebody had asked me to do, so I went and did it. But it coincided with Father's Day as well.
Right.
And during the Friday, I remember Charlotte, my wife, saying, "You know, I think things are starting to happen and what have you." And I was like, "Yeah, but you know, I've got a race this weekend, you know." Yeah, you're sure, kind of thing. So I went and did the day's testing. Luckily, it was at Donington. We only live an hour away from Donington, so it wasn't in my eyes, it wasn't the end of the world. But so I went and did the day's testing on the Friday, and I returned home, and she'd gone a bit further, sort of by that point. And so I sat with her all of Friday night into the early hours of Saturday, and you know, she not got any further. So either I said, "Well, you put this qualifying and what have you now," I might as well just go and do that. I'm on the end of the phone, you know, you need me to come back, you know, I'm kind of here. So it wasn't as straightforward as I'm making it sound, but obviously, you know, she said, "Yeah, off you go," kind of thing. But we'd always elected to have a home birth anyway.
Okay.
So she phoned the midwife, and the midwife and her small team came and joined her at the house. So, you know, at least there was somebody there. I'm not that bad. Left her. So we did qualify, and we actually qualified on pole, so it was worth going.
Amazing.
And then
You had
and
to,
then returned
really.
home. Yeah. Otherwise, I'd never heard the end of it, though. So got back on that Saturday night, and yeah, she had dilation had progressed at that point in time, but you know, I mean, it was like something like 28 hours of labour, I think, in the end. So it was a long labour for Charlotte, and the midwife just suggested, you know, why don't you just go into your own bedroom, put on some candles, just dim the light, and just lay and just relax. And sometimes, because she tried everything else, you know, she'd had the curry, she'd bounced on the ball, you know, done everything that you see and hear.
Yeah.
And I think she managed to fall asleep for like an hour, and then all of a sudden, like, yeah, it just went just a lot quicker then.
Yeah.
And Imogen was born in the early hours, around 4 a.m. I think it was. And I mean, you know, you've probably experienced this now, but you know, obviously the baby's born and they're kind of handed over to you, and you then sort of like, but now what? What do I, you know, what do I do? There is no manual for this, is there?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
As parents, I don't mean me as a father. I mean, as parents, we were sort of like, okay, what do we look out for?
Yeah, you kind of, sometimes you don't really want to leave the hospital, because then you've got no one to ask questions to.
So Maria, the midwife, she delivered all three of our children, actually, just funny enough. She was like, oh, I'll make you, you know, I'll go downstairs, I'll make you tea and toast. You just you know, have a quiet 10 minutes. But that's what we did. She gave us tea and toast, and sort of like went, you know, I'm kind of off now. And off she went. And it was probably, I don't know, 7 in the morning, 7:30.
Yeah.
You know, the inevitable question came, well, it's race day. The baby's here now. Am I off?
No.
Which again, Charlotte just said, you know, yeah, go on, you get yourself off. I don't know.
Incredible.
So we went and did. There was two races that day, and we won the first race. But then the second race, actually, when I jumped into the car, I actually made a mistake while leading and spun, but didn't spin and crash. I just spun, dropped a second. 30 seconds behind the leader or something. And I remember Warren, you know, the teammate at the time, I just felt tired, you know, I mean, I've not given birth, but, I did feel tired, and I think that's why I made the mistake. And I remember Warren being on the radio, because I thought, there's no way I can make 30 seconds up in the time remaining, you know, just no chance in it. And I remember him getting on the radio and saying, you know, come on, you know, you can do this, just get your head down, be consistent, put it in, and I did, and I passed him, and we won, which was brilliant. And then in the post race interviews, you know, I dedicated the win to Imogen, who'd just been born, and to Charlotte, who'd just given birth.
Wow, amazing!
Yeah.
I mean, you created Charlotte. A great story for her.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly it. So obviously every 4 years it drops where it's Father's Day and her birthday, you know, so we always then recollect the story.
The story, yeah.
So,
which I'm sure Charlotte loves her part in it.
I know you asked it a little while ago, but yeah, going back and looking at some of the highs, you know, the grassroots karting, the Le Mans stuff. You know, doing a race when Imogen was born, high or low, depending on who you speak to, you know, me deserting Charlotte would have been a low for her, but you know, some absolutely fabulous times. And I do think that's somebody that, you know, anybody Joe Public can reach out and do it on whatever budget suits them. You know, no one says you have to go and put tyres on every single race meeting or whatever. I think, you know, you can go and find an environment where you can be successful, and you know, you don't have to spend the earth on it, and quite evidently get maximum enjoyment out of it, whether you finish 10th, 20th, you've not finished, or you've won the race. I think doing that with your family, you know, certainly gave us a much tighter special bond, one that I've considered for my family, for instance.
Yeah.
You know, so I have Rory, who's the youngest of my three. He's 7.
And have you put him in a car yet?
Yeah, I have taken him. So nowadays, even to just do the little corporate stuff that we're referring to, even as a kid, they've got to do like a little bit of a test and gain like a little bit of a license. It's not
okay.
It is official, but it's not. You know, you can't go proper racing on it. I took him and let him do that, and he has asked me a few times to, you know, can he go back? Can he do it? But I just know where that could lead. You know, me as a competitive sportsman, you know, want him to do well in, well, any of them to do well in their sport. And I just think if he's doing car racing, I just know what's required, and I know I'll have to try and deliver it somehow.
Yeah.
you know, he loves his football, and I'm wholeheartedly behind that.
There's more money in it, I think.
yeah, exactly. I think it is. Yeah.
Nice holiday in Saudi Arabia will go down nicely.
yeah. It's, I've loved watching him. You know, he's played for a full year now, and I've loved that. I really have loved that.
On a previous podcast, I had a guy called Richard Evans on, who works for a firm who does recruitment for retired athletes. And he was talking to me about the struggles of athletes once they've completed their career, and it's like, what do they do next? And they're actually quite a unique recruitment agency, because they're the only one that exists that specifically does this for athletes. And it sounds like it is quite a tough one, quite a dilemma for anyone who has to retire at such an early age from their career to then what to do next. So how did you kind of transition from and decide what to do after you stopped driving?
So in between that time of finishing that first single seat a year or half a year, and I refer to the sponsor who'd kind of started his own team, you know, it meant I could work a little bit in that team, and I spent a year being a dog's body, basically. But then the second half of the year, I was elevated to team manager, just, you know, to try it, and I was good at it. I wouldn't say I enjoyed it, because I much, 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 much prefer the engineering side of it than the organizational and operational side of it. I prefer that side of it. But it's kind of like it was a bit of a role that I kind of fell into a little bit. And then between then and now, I've kind of done it a little bit sporadically through my life. And then when the driving stopped in 2014, it's meant I've been able to focus a little bit more on that. And that's what I've done ever since.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's, from my point of view, having driven, having done the engineering and all that sort of side of it, and then into the management side of it, you kind of then get a fully rounded view of everything. And I think that then puts you in a good position and a respected position, you know, when you're speaking with your colleagues about, you know, decisions to be made and how do we maximize our operations and procedures and all that sort of stuff. So I kind of fell into it a while ago, but I've been in, you know, team management now for 10 solid years, probably. I still prefer the engineering, though. I'd much rather go and do that.
Did you find it quite hard not being a racing driver anymore?
I think the desire to get behind the wheel is always going to be there. I'm in a very lucky position that I've done some very prestigious races. You know, obviously being successful in my own right, not everybody's right, but in my own right, you know, I've been successful and I've ticked quite a few of those boxes. You know, I always said, if somebody said, it stops there and you never drive a racing car ever again, I'd be pleased with what I've done. So
yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, naturally, if anybody says, go and have a go. I mean, I went karting with some friends the other day, at one of the biggest kart tracks in the UK, outdoor. And I took it just as seriously as I did when I did Le Mans.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just something that comes immediately flooding back, you know.
Yeah, you can't turn it off.
No, you know, I mean, you know, I have. Yeah, you know, some people say that. Oh, but why don't you just slow down and we can have a bit of a race, or you know, and we can. I'm like, I don't think so. No, you're all right. I just go and do the fastest thing. You know, I just complete it, even if it's on my own and I've lapped everybody four times or whatever it might be. Just deliver the ultimate performance. Like I said before, it just costs so much money and. Even if you could do it in a scenario that didn't really cost a great deal of money, what happens if you crash it?
Yeah.
You know, there's all that to it. You know, these cars are insured, you know, particularly the level that we're operating at. But, you know, you might be talking of £25,000 excess.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Crazy.
You know, they're just not cheap, you know, and that is not money I can afford to. You know, just because I've decided to have a bit of a play about or whatever, you know, if something goes wrong, somebody runs into you. You know, there is no, you know, not like on the road where somebody drives into the back of you, it's their fault and it's on their insurance. Motorsport doesn't work like that. If the car's damaged, that's your responsibility, whether you were in it or you were out of it.
Yeah.
I did actually have a scenario like that where in a British GT car, in a Porsche, I made a small mistake at Alton Park. And it resulted in me being on the grass and I spun. And it spun backwards into the tyre wall, but it was only a low tyre wall. And the way that the rear bumper was shaped in a Porsche at that point in time meant it actually rode up the barrier slightly. Didn't do hardly any damage. If it was £100 worth of damage, that was all it did. But it remained beached on the tyres. And obviously I was calling to the marshals and they were sort of giving me the, you know, it, get out, it's dead kind of scenario. So I got out and I'm stood on the side and it was a practice session. And I remember saying to them, do you not think you should red flag the session? It's in quite a dangerous position there, you know.
Yeah.
I'm only 80 yards off the circuit there. Somebody could do exactly what I've just done. They're going to hit the car and do a lot more damage than what's done to it currently. And they said, oh no, don't worry about it. It's only like 15 minutes of the session. Race controls confirmed over the radio. They're just going to cover it by double yellow flags. And I said, all right, fine. I said, but I'm speaking to you as a racing driver. You know, once you've been through this section once, understood what the double yellows are for, you just keep pushing. There's no, I'm going to slow down.
Because
the danger's off track. Sure enough, what happened? 5 minutes later, somebody did exactly what I did, crashed into the car I'd been driving, wrote his car off and wrote my car off. Knocked himself out, actually, as well.
Really? Bloody hell.
But I wasn't even in the car.
Yeah, I suppose you can't claim against them.
So now, in that scenario, I was into, I can't remember what the excess was at that point in time, but that cost me the money. I wasn't even sat in it.
Yeah.
Brilliant, isn't it? The costs are just so silly. They invent or they get control of some scenarios, you know, every 10 years. But then it's like now, it's getting to a point where these cars, like I said, cost £750,000. They cost £250,000 15, 20 years ago, you know. So I won't be surprised if GT3, you know, in the next 10 years doesn't get stopped and GT4 is the new premier class.
And all your money is just from sponsors, really.
Yeah, I mean, so there are many different types of racing driver kicking around in the world. But, you know, you've got the young hotshots, you know, whose dad's paying for it, you know, because their business has done well. You know, also off the back of that, they may go and recruit sponsors, as you say. In our world, in GT3, it's mostly populated by very wealthy amateur drivers. So that'll be business owners that are earning millions through their businesses.
Because it's not like you've got huge crowds and on Sky Sports One and all that type of thing. So it doesn't look that an appeal like that much of an appealing sport to kind of throw money into from the
No.
outside looking in.
No. No. You're quite right. You don't get McDonald's plastered down the side of a racing car because McDonald's want to enhance their European or British coverage. What typically happens in our sector is, that amateur driver will put his company name on the car, but it's then more about B2B. He's then in the next garage is a guy who's in the exact same position as him. He might own a haulage company, so the guy next door spends £2 million on haulage every year, and if he can save a few quid by giving it to Fred next door, that's what happens. And it's just that, really. There is no out and outright benefit to just ploughing money into a team to sponsor a car. Certainly not in the UK, anyway. It exists a little bit more in Europe, I would say. But it's just rich men going racing. It's just a grotesque exploitation of money, really, if you want my honest opinion.
It seems far removed from what you're saying about grassroots motorsport, really.
It's a shame. But as I say, it's just cycles. We've been here before. Something else will get created, or they'll clamp down on. I mean, the world of motorsport naturally is under massive scrutiny about its sustainability and its carbon footprint, and why not? It is an industry that consumes a lot of those products. So one thing, we can do is limit the amount of sets of tires you can use over the weekend. You can use different types of fuel, not travel around on private jets or, whatever it might be. There's lots of things that can be done, that should be done, that will be done, and it will happen. It just takes a while for the privateer teams such as us that can eventually end up doing it, where it doesn't cost more money to do. We're not in that same. I know I saw Formula One at the Red Bull Ring, and were powering the entire paddock, I think, via solar panels and green generators and stuff like this. But
You
it's
can't
not something
go
we
out and
can
spend the
just.
money to do that.
Nah. So I get it. It's a step forward, and it has to be trialed and, seeing if it can happen. If circuits start putting that in and what have you, and then you tap into that power and you pay the circuit, more money, then yeah, I can see that all working. But to ask us as teams to go and buy all that new equipment, it's just not possible.
Team manager currently, and if, when you finish racing, it sounds like you fell into that fairly quickly, but, from transitioning from racing driver to team manager. So has that been your kind of, is that what you've been solely doing since you've finished in the last kind of going on 10 years now, I guess?
Yes, as a career, yeah. Sort of after university and in association with the guy that was telling you about, who owned his own team. He was able to own his own team because he had a metal commodities business. Now, that was somebody that I was introduced via my dad, actually. So when my dad worked in the engineering company that I told you about, he used to sell all his scrap metal that came out of the engineering firm to this gentleman's father. And then they realized they'd got a common interest in motorsport, struck a chord. He then ended up taking over a bit more of his dad's scrap metal firm and what have you, and started to run it. And that's where that original relationship came from. And via that method, that's where my single-seater sponsorship came from. Now, it since transpires, I've learned this a lot later on, that the reason he stopped it really was because his father's business was stopping and he was starting up as a under his own business.
Okay.
And that's why he then returned to me with opportunities 2 years later. So that pieces that little bit together. And then, as I say, I started to work in my summer holidays from university and whatever in that racing team. And then as my university period finished, I then went and then worked for him in the motorsport team, but also in his metal commodities business.
Right.
And I that's where I learned how to trade scrap metal, but also to trade primary metals and sell them around the UK and around Europe.
Okay.
Now, during that period, I'd become, you know, very well thought of there. Was part of the management there. And one day he called me and another elderly fellow up to his house and said one of the customers that we had gone bust on him, and it meant his business would have to close. Did we fancy starting our own business up, largely in the same sort of sector? We could rent the premises, you know, and largely there wouldn't be any change.
Mm.
But you guys would be fully part of management, directorship, shareholding. And I was in my early 20s at that point in time, and if I'm honest, saw pound signs and thought that sounds like a brilliant opportunity. Yeah. It'll help me, you know, do my motor racing, etc., etc. So I said yes. Now, throughout that period then, things started to get sticky for him in terms of there was some fairly serious organisations making investigations into his life and how that whole situation had concluded. And it actually transpires that there was no customer that went bankrupt on him. He actually ended up owing the Crown quite a lot of money.
Right.
And as a consequence, was therefore investigating how our business had started and his involvement within it and what have you, you know, stepping into realms that I had got no idea about in terms of legality. And obviously it then got quite serious involving solicitors, etc. And that period went on for quite a while.
Right.
To the point where it got too serious that the authorities decided that business needed closing because it was deemed that it was just a continuation of his business, and therefore any monies that were owed or earned within that period were all part of his original debt and estate.
Right.
Anyway.
Okay.
So all very surprising news to me, and obviously trying to navigate our way through that process was a very difficult one. So that, as I say, that business closed, which almost did mean the end of my driving. Actually, the two things ended up coinciding.
Right.
But unfortunately for me then, a few years later, I think largely down to the way that he conducted himself through that process, I think he got their backs up. He'd lied a lot through the process.
Mm.
They then brought criminal charges about for him. But as a natural direct consequence of that, meant there had to be criminal proceedings brought about to the business I was a director of, and therefore as a director, I was liable for those charges also.
Right.
And you know, I don't mind saying, Dan, I was massively naive to that process. I didn't realise, you know, allowing him to work in it, allowing him to make decisions in it. I trusted him. He'd given me a great lifestyle. He'd given me a motorsport career that you know I longed for. You know, so maybe I should have been. Well, no, should have been. I 100% should have been. You know, much wiser to the scenario. You know, as a director, getting yourselves involved in responsibilities like that, you know, I should have asked a lot more questions. I should have taken advice, but I didn't. I just didn't. You know,
I was
young and saw a different way for myself.
Yeah.
But it got myself into some extremely hot water. And you know, throughout that court process, when they through the criminal proceedings, they unfortunately found me guilty of allowing him to do all those things. And you know, I'm disappointed to tell you that resulted in a custodial sentence.
Wow.
So I was sentenced to close to 6 years imprisonment,
okay.
which, you know, under those rules, you know, you serve close to 3 years. So,
Yeah.
so for three of those years that you're referring to, that's where I was. I'm by no means proud of that period of my life. You know, I didn't think, or I can tell you now, didn't set out in that process to commit any criminal offence or hurt anybody or take money away from the Crown or whatever it might have, you know, whatever the conclusion to it was, you know, that I just didn't. But I do accept that I had responsibilities in it that I now know of.
Yeah.
There was offences there that I committed that I didn't know I was committing, you know, and I did say throughout all that process to, you know, the prosecution in particular and to my own barrister, I just don't see how it can be fair, not fair, I don't see how it can be right that you can literally just go online now and create a limited company and sign yourself up as a director, basically by a tick box exercise. You know, I know there are UK laws, or there are laws that we all must follow as members of the public. I absolutely respect that. But I do think when you're entering business, I do think there are ways you need to behave, there are rules you need to follow that are not always particularly transparent. And obviously tapping into resources that are aware of those things is 100% what I would recommend anybody as a business owner, as a director.
Yeah.
You know, no matter how much you think you know about something, you know, I would pretty much guarantee you don't know it all.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I've been a director of a few companies, and I know it's so easy to become a director, to create a business, to incorporate a business. It is just an online form to be able to do that.
Yeah.
And I guess I'm sure there's a lot of people out there that don't know the legalities of what they're signing up to by doing that and what their responsibilities are. So, I mean, 3 years is not a short time. It's a long time to be locked up for. And how did that affect you? How was that time?
I mean, you know, if I talk about me personally, then that just sounds exceptionally selfish. You know, what I did learn throughout the whole process is it's not really you as that person doing the sentence. It's quite often they're not the family surrounding you, you know, for my wife and for my children, and the wider extended family. That is a really, really difficult period, you know, for many different levels. You know, for Charlotte as my wife, you know, where we've committed to things to do with houses, mortgages, cars, whatever it might be financially. You know, suddenly, you know, you're cutting that income by whatever percentage. And suddenly you've got to fill that void, you know. But as a single parent, you're now being asked to earn more money, however that may be, or save more money, or cut back on some of those things. But feed and house and clothe and keep warm, you know, three children, let alone herself.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so it is that wider spread impact. You're having on people that is terrible. You know, for me going through that process, of course it's awful. You know, it's not a nice environment. It's designed to be awful, so you never go back. Of course, you know. But yeah, you know, some awful things you see here get subject to. You know, it's there as punishment, isn't it? But
yeah,
you know,
and the type of
know,
other people you're in there, whether they. I mean, the type of crime they committed, is it all sorts of stuff, or are you kind of just with a kind of low key finance criminals and things?
No, I wish it was that, but no, you know, you are all thrown in there, you know, as a collective criminal. You know, there is no differentiation. You know, the period at which you know, I was sentenced, it was attached to the monetary value. And that's how, in those particular cases, which are fraud cases, you know, that's how the sentencing guidelines are dictated to. You know, what was your level of involvement within it, and what is the monetary value attached to said crime? You know, so yeah. And you know, without a doubt, you know, when it's business, you know, naturally there'll always be higher sums than if you're doing any crimes as individuals. So naturally, you get sentenced to longer periods of times. That's yeah. not a criticism of the system. I'm not for 1 second saying that. I'm just saying that's how, you know, you end up with the length of time you know, cause, you know, like you say now, you know, that 6 years, that sounds like that's a pretty serious, and of course it is serious. Mm. You know, I'm not shouldering from it whatsoever, but it comes with attachment of the monetary value, and obviously there is a period of time that went over, and if that's, you know, whatever, a 6 year period, it's, you know, that is you as turnover, that is a lot of money.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah, you know that, you know, prison itself is not a nice place to be. Mm. You know,
but yeah, like you say, incredibly tough for Charlotte to cope with it all.
Yeah.
Without you there and everything that surrounds that with the kids and money, but she managed to kind of keep it all together and was there for you when you got out.
Yeah. I mean, you know, like you said, there are many walks of life in there, you know, so yeah, the best way I can liken it, or the best way I can tell anybody to try and deal with it is you've got to be a chameleon. You know, in 1 second, you know, you're talking to a white collar crime, you know, financial person, you know, mm. who's as sharp as a button and, you know, can talk about politics and the world economy or, you know, mm. whatever it might be. And then you bump into, you know, a mass murderer, you know, and but you've got to have a conversation with those two people.
Yeah.
If, you know, in order to keep yourself safe or to blend it. Yeah, to blend in, you know, not that I'm saying that, you know, I want to be best buddies with,
mm.
you know, a mass murderer. I'm not saying that, but you've got to try and avoid it.
Mm.
Yeah, exactly. And you've got to try and fit, you know, the consequences of not fitting can be quite dire.
Yeah.
You know? You know, but one thing that we all said, you know, what we all typically have in common is, you know, you acknowledge, or the people that acknowledge their crimes, you know, realize, you know, you're in there and you're doing what you're doing, but it's the people on the outside that are the rocks. They're the ones that, you know, are holding it all together. And, you know, at the end of the day, you're being fed. Mm. You've got a roof over you. You've got somewhere to sleep at night. You're being looked after. You know, if Charlotte doesn't, you know, if the mortgage is £500 that month, she don't bring in £500. The mortgage company don't say, oh, don't worry about it, Charlotte. Jody's in the nick. Don't worry about it. You know, just owe us it. You know, you're out, aren't you?
Mm.
You know, so
you don't have to worry about that, all that where you are.
No, the pressure's all I can do is, you know, get on with it in there, and, you know, not be stupid, you know, and want to buy, you know, the latest pair of Adidas, you know, poppers, mm. you know, because the rest of the wing are wearing them, you know, and therefore Charlotte needs to buy me them, you know, which is what I saw a lot of, you know, you know, I've run out of vapes, can you just send £4 in, and, you know, yeah, there's so much of that, you know, so just not trying to be a further burden on it. You know, I mean, I was, you know, with the way the system works, you know, there's certain security categories, and as you start to get towards the latter end of the sentence, some people, the well-behaved people, the people that are conforming, the people that are showing remorse, etc., and of which you go under quite a tight scrutiny process whilst you're in there,
right.
Reach security category D.
Okay.
which then means you move prison status, move establishment into an open conditions prison, which is where I ended up. And as part of that rehabilitation process, they like to try and get you out into the workplace. So you just naturally starting to migrate into society again. So I was lucky enough to be able to do that and ended up at a motor racing team, so I could continue doing what I knew and
that's
what I
really
loved,
good.
and financially for that team, that they're not paying the wages you would normally get as a team manager. They're paying the minimum wage, which is dictated to by the prison service. The prison service receive a massive portion of that money. The rest of it I was able to send home to Charlotte to help. So for that team that you're working at, they've got a very skilled individual for minimum wage, effectively.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I'd like to think in that process I was able to bring my own skill set, but
yeah.
obviously minimal cost to the team, so it helped sort of migrate back into it a little bit.
Okay. And how were the kids coping with it all? Were they able to come and visit you?
So the two girls, Imogen and Madison, have always been very mature girls. They've always been people that you can have more grown up conversations than most. So Charlotte talked about it quite a lot and felt that we could tell the girls what had happened and where I was. Because no matter how much, we always don't like to admit it, people do say stuff, so Charlotte stepping into the school playground, she was aware of parents, etc., now giving her the cold shoulder or talking about it behind her back, but very disappointingly so. The children then get something similar from kids in the school, which they've only got from their parents as well. So it was almost rather they had the information and know how to respond to it via us than just be getting it, as a complete shock from another school child.
Yeah.
So we elected to tell them, and they took it well. Naturally, they were obviously very upset about it all. But for Rory, who was younger, we told him that I was just purely working away, and that once I reached the different security levels of prison, the environment's a little bit different. So one, you feel a little bit more comfortable in being able to take the kids into and being able to, sort of see you. But, that might have been two years down the line, So, so they did all eventually come and see me, but under circumstances that we were a bit happier with.
I mean, it's incredible really how Charlotte managed to cope with all that. And since coming out, has it been a very different kind of scenario to beforehand, and the way you're kind of having to live? And
I mean, there's many different elements to it. Obviously, when you first get sentenced and, you're taken away and whatever, for months afterwards, obviously then Charlotte's dealing with all that, people saying stuff, her having to tell the story, which is her that's answering it now. It's not me, I'm away from it all. You don't really have to deal with it, but for her, she dealt with it for quite a long time afterwards. And then that same process actually then gets repeated when you come back, because now you're back. Oh, he's back. Well, yeah, where was he? And, all gets dug up a little bit again. So when I first came out, it was really difficult for us, as a relationship. Because, before I went away, typically I'd be the one that would deal with a lot of the bills and things like that, so now all of a sudden Charlotte's dealing with all of that. So then when I come back, she's dealing with it all, so I'm not dealing with it all, and it's finding finding that balance between.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's just, many different levels. It's a fundamental shift in the responsibilities of the relationship.
Right.
You know, you don't love each other any less. If anything, it's grown stronger because of what you've just been through. So
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
more of those kind of things. It's better, you know. And Charlotte had to get her head down. You know, she with the help of her dad and whatever, she actually started her own business.
Okay.
In a similar sort of working, well, in exactly the same working line as a dad, but managed to do it herself. Which is property management, and she's made an absolute booming success of that.
Right.
In her own right. But in her own, you know, absolutely amazing. You know, and she'd tell me on the phone. Would speak, you know, every day or every other day, and she'd be telling me what had happened and what she was aiming for and what she was trying to do. And I just said to her, I said, it's absolutely amazing, you know, like you're an absolute rock, you know.
To do that with three kids on your own,
yeah,
it's just incredible.
Yeah, without a doubt, and I'm immensely proud of what she's done. Not just. You know, because she's got that now, but I mean, as a person, you know, to have stood firm and to have got through everything, the children are impeccably mannered. You know, that everybody always says it, that, you know, they say the please, the thank yous, they speak well, they're very intelligent, you know, they generally exceed at what they're doing in school, you know, they've got a social life, they've got friends. They do out of school clubs, sports.
Yeah,
you know, they're just everything that you would expect of a perfectly well-rounded family. Mm. You know, that's credit to her. You know, the girls were a little bit older, so probably their personalities were formed a little bit more. Their mentality towards life, towards people, towards values.
Yeah,
was a little bit more formed, and therefore I'd had a lot more of an input into those kind of things. But for Rory. You know, who was 5 when I returned, so was 2 when I went. He wasn't, you know, he'd not learnt that yet. You know, he learnt it whilst I was away. So a lot of who he is and who he's become is largely down to Charlotte, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I will never get those years back to be able to say, you know, a lot of what he's become is down to the pair of us. I'm obviously rubbing off on him now, and you know, and he changes now because there's the two of us. But you know, that's upsetting to admit. You know, to be perfectly blunt.
I've got a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old, and to think that I would now go away for 3 years and not see them, and to see how to miss that part of their lives is, you know, I couldn't imagine. Could imagine not being around right now.
A very, very difficult period, you know, but one of my own creation, you know. Don't get me wrong, I'm not blaming anybody else other than myself for it, you know. So you know, but now it's just about, you know, moving forward as a family, you know, obviously establishing myself back into family life, working life. You know, it was difficult. I heard it a lot, you know, them saying difficult when you get back out. It's a bit it's a bit daunting. I mean, even on, this is going to sound really strange to you, but even on those like day releases, or I was going to work or whatever, and you know, I go to the supermarket, you know, to buy my lunch or whatever. You know you're an inmate, working out, you know, and you obviously just, you start thinking, you know, people are looking at you. Not like you're in a banana suit or you know, or a black and white striped suit or anything. Nothing like that. You never know.
Yeah.
But just subconsciously, it's just
feel like.
Yeah, and quite rightly so. Obviously, the prison service have very strict guidelines, criteria, rules that you must follow when you're on those.
Because the only thing I could really relate it to is when we were in lockdown and coming out of lockdown, having not been socializing for so long, not seeing any of my friends or anyone and not going anywhere. And I remember the first times I was starting to meet up with people and go to pubs or whatever, I felt quite anxious leading up to it and kind of going, oh, I don't know if I want to go. And I don't, and what do I say to people? I don't know. Like in that scenario. And it was a very strange feeling. And I can imagine it's that sort of thing that you're experiencing coming back into real life.
Yeah, exactly. It's, it was a bit strange. And, you know, Charlotte clocked it. You know, she'd say, you know, you all right? Or I'm just like, yeah. It's just because, you know, obviously doing anything wrong in there or on your outwork or anything like that, you know, obviously gets severely punished. You know, it takes so much of just not just, but like your own life choices, like you know. So you know, luckily, I mean, not luckily, but because I behaved myself. But you know, people who didn't behave, you know, would have things taken away. But that then meant, in you know, the people in charge would choose what meals you were going to eat, or when you go to the toilet, or do you know. So it's like some of your very raw life skills or life choices that are taken away from you. So anything, as I say, that you do wrong, that is the consequence. So you live like that for a while and you get accustomed to it. So then coming out and, you know, just you know, somebody, like I say, the supermarket, somebody looking at you and you think they're thinking, oh, is he going to nick someone?
Which you quite evidently not.
You know what I mean? But it just like you say, just anxiety a little bit. I mean, I'm not an anxious person. I'm not that.
No.
But I did feel it coming out of there.
So team manager now, I mean, what next? Have you got any aspirations in the future, or are you just kind of fully focused on what you're doing now?
No, I'm fully focused on what I'm doing now. You know, I don't have any aspirations to go and take over the world, you know, or anything like that. What I learned, you know, through that process was, there are, like I'm saying, just simple life choices. There are, you take a lot more value out of just normality, you know, and that's perfectly fine, you know, to just know, yeah, I'm going to go home this evening. I'm going to pick my son up. We're going to have tea together, and then we're going to go and do some football training. You know, he goes, for an hour. That's great. You know, I love that. Or, you know, last night the girls went dancing because they're practicing for a show that I'm going to go and watch in a week. You know, and it just, you know, again, that might sound, well, that's sort of, that is what normal life is, and I know that, and I've learned to know that, but that's not what my life was. You know, it was, oh, next week I'm going to Le Mans 24 hour to drive. You know, that it was a lot more expectation out of what was occurring, The process has taught me to value just everyday normal things, which has been nice.
Well, I know I'm guilty, and I know a lot of people are guilty of not kind of living in the moment and not appreciating what's happening right now. And you're always looking at what's next, what I'm doing this to get to somewhere, and you're constantly working on that, even whether it's your career or socially, or even like when you're on holiday. Like, I've spoken to friends about, we go on holiday, we'd sit there planning the next holiday. It's like, let's enjoy what we're doing right now. Or you're planning what you're going to do while you're on holiday. It's like, let's just enjoy being on holiday. And it's the same with daily life. You can often be constantly planning and aiming for the next thing and how to get there, that you're not living in the moment and enjoying. And especially when you've got young kids, to enjoy that part of your life, it can flash straight in front of your eyes and you've missed it, I think. So, I mean, you've managed to get into that headspace, not in the most conventional way, but you managed to get there. And I think a lot of people would want to be in that headspace where we are just appreciating kind of everything around us day to day.
Yeah, it's been, like you said, just a very odd way of coming about it, but you know, I think what the system's there for has worked for me. You know, it's fundamentally taught me a lesson of, you know, the naivety or you know, whatever the mistakes I made, you know, that weren't through conscious decision to commit crime. You know, just I have committed a crime. I've just done it unconsciously, if you like, or subconsciously. Yeah. Yeah, you know. So then it teaches you a very different process, different set of values. You know, whatever. And which is why, you know, when you said to me about, you know, getting behind the wheel again or whatever, you know, I realised what a very privileged position that is, and you know, that's not something I've earned anymore or whatever. And the materialistic things and what have you have generally drifted away, you know, for me.
Yeah. Well, I mean, all credit to you and especially Charlotte and the kids for being what they've gone through and coming out the other side and being the kind of family you are now is amazing, really, to be where you are mentally and everything is great to see. And all credit to you. So yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, thanks ever so much for coming on, Jody. It's been a fascinating tale of your life, really, and everything you've been through. It's been I'm sure a lot of people will be absolutely fascinated by everything you've experienced and told us. But yeah, again, thank you ever so much. It's been an absolute pleasure.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay. Cheers, Jody.
Cheers, mate.